Hi, Miguel. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Thank you.
Excellent. Great to hear. So everybody, we've got Miguel Cairo here. If you know you'll have some questions for Miguel, please go ahead and raise your hand. And as we said, we're going to do the questions in English first. And when we finish with those, we have some Spanish-speaking media on Miguel. So they want to have some questions for you in Spanish.
Of course.
So first question, Scott Merkin. Go ahead, Scott.
Hey, Miguel. How you doing?
I'm doing good, man. How you doing?
Good. Thank you. Just basically, what interested you about this job? I know you know Tony La Russa, you know, from before, but what interested you about the bench coach job with the White Sox?
You know, I think it's a great opportunity. You know, I play for him, and I learned so much about the game. One of the reasons that I play so many years is because him, he's a staff in St. Louis, and, you know, you always keep learning. And this is a great opportunity for me to learn from him, being beside him and the same team as a coach. And, you know, it was a little premature for me. I really went away for my daughter to graduate from high school. She's a sophomore. And, you know, but I cannot pass on this opportunity to be besides a Hall of Famer. Tony, that's going to be an unbelievable experience.
Vinny Duber.
Hi, Miguel. How are you?
I'm doing good, Vinny.
What are some of the things that you learned from Tony during your playing days that you have kind of taken into this next phase of your career?
I learned how to win. That's something that, you know, he hate losing. I hate losing. And something that you learn with him is about how to be a professional, first of all, and how to win. You know, I think he's one of the most prepared manager I ever been with, and you can tell by his record. You know, he don't miss anything, and he's way ahead of another team. He managed the team before, he managed the game before the game happened. So it's unbelievable how smart he is and how well prepared he is.
Chuck Garfine.
Hey, Miguel, Chuck Garfine here. Nice to meet you. Welcome to the White Sox.
Thank you.
What is it about, I mean, you mentioned about working with Tony, but what is it about the White Sox, this team, that has you excited and why you think this team has a chance to do something special and you want to be a part of it?
Oh, my gosh. It's the talent that they have. You know, it's amazing the kind of players they have. And, you know, they already got a taste of what is to be in the playoff. Now is, you know, get a taste of going to the promised land. That's what I call it. You know, I learned that from Cheo Kendall when he was in San Luis. It's the promised land is the World Series, that beautiful, and, you know, and celebrate, you know, after the season in Chicago. That, you know, if you see Chicago as one of the cities that, you know, they know how to celebrate a championship. And it would be awesome to get a ring in a, and be beside these guys, because they got so much talent. It is crazy. I watch games on TV, and you know they really enjoy it. Something that I noticed, they're enjoying playing the game. They're enjoying, you know, beating another team, and that's what it's about. You know, it's about getting that W in the end of the day and winning.
James Fegan. Go ahead, James.
And Miguel, what was it about playing under Tony and getting to know Tony that made you feel like your philosophies and approach to the game would be a match where you could kind of work together as a way a bench coach and a manager do?
You know, something that, you know, like, you know, I played every day for 3 years with Tampa Bay. And when I went to St. Louis, before I was in the Cubs, I went to St. Louis and I learned how to watch the game. I learned how to, you know, about the details of the game. And that's something that he's all about, you know, the little details that make a big difference in a game. And you know, just watching the game, you can learn so much. And that's what I did. You know, like I'm telling you, I was kind of managing when I first started being a utility player. That was my mentality. I gotta learn the game. I want to know what he does in some situation, when he changed pitchers. And I always ask questions. You know, I was a player, I was in the bench, and something that he does is he makes you in a position to succeed. Every time, even if he's going to pinch you or he's going to play you that day, he will let you know with time. And that's something that you respect for him, because he always give you a heads up when you're going to play it, or if you're going to pinch it against a pitcher that you may don't have a good matchup. He say, hey, I'm sorry, I'm going to use you. And, you know, you live with that. The communication he got with his player was amazing. And you knew I knew my role. And that's something that, you know, when you have a team, you want everyone, every player to know their role so like that they can succeed. And he would be those kids, those players in a place to where they're going to succeed.
Daryl Venskowen. Go ahead, Daryl.
Miguel, seems like a bench coach often wears different hats. What do you see as your primary job description, your responsibilities in that role?
I'm going to be his right-hand man. I'm going to be make sure everyone is engaged in the game, make sure everyone is enjoying winning. And, you know, like I always going to – something that I did with Dusty when I did it for 6 months over there in Cincinnati after I retired from playing, I'm going to be in his ear. I'm going to, you know, make a suggestion. You know that Tony is well prepared. Tony is going to be ready for everything, but he might be seeing something that I see differently. I will make my comment, but I'm going to help him in everything he can, mostly with the players in the dugout too, make sure, you know, everyone is engaged in what we're doing in the game.
Are you going to be working with the infielder specifically, or is that still going to be kind of Joe McEwing's job?
Super Joe is going to be working. I'm going to be helping everyone. I'm going to be helping him. I'm going to be working in base running. So it's going to be like a teamwork, and, you know, hopefully, I think the way always Tony has been, you know, working with the coaches, everyone, we're going to be together in everything that we're going to do. And, of course, I'm going to help Super Joe.
Lamont Pope, the Tribune. Go ahead, Lamont.
Well, Miguel, you mentioned your time in Cincinnati after you retired. Just what were some of the things that you learned while you were in Cincinnati and also with the New York Yankees after you retired? Yeah.
I'm gonna explain you why I did everything that I've been doing, and I know it was a little too early, but you know, right after I played, you know, I was blessed to play for really good winning managers, and I learned so much from all those managers. And when I retired, Walt Jocketty, you know, offered me, you know, I asked him to, you know, to see if I want to stay in the game, and I asked him if I can be his assistant, because I want to learn another part of the game, front office, how they make moves, how, you know, the prospects, how they, you know, all the little 40-man roster, all the stuff that's going on, all the meetings, how they go through, who's going to get called up. I really want to learn all that stuff. And, you know, thanks to him, they opened the door for me to do that. It gave me the chance to know what is going on, not in the field, but upstairs. It's a different ball game out there. And right after that, I really want to do something that I was in charge of doing. You know, that was my department, my gig. I want to develop, you know, players. And when I went to the Yankees as an infield coordinator, it was a great experience. It was, I learned how to deal with players, with coaches under me, and, you know, the respect that I got for those guys, although the infield coaches that we had over there, it was unbelievable. And more how to deal with the players, different personalities, different, you know, it's more than just the game. It's, you know, outside the field and other stuff. And I really want to learn that. And now this is my second phase. You know, I really want to coach. And now that I got, you know, I'm putting every piece together, the puzzle, you know, it's kind of cool to, I want to learn the whole thing. I want to be able to understand everything that's going on.
James Fegan.
Hey, Miguel, a lot has been made about how managing has changed since Tony was last in the dugout in 2011, with how it's become more data-focused. You've been in the front office since then. He's been in the front office since then. Have you guys talked about how your preparation or approach to the game would adjust to, you know, the way the baseball is now?
And no, I don't have a conversation with him about that yet. You know, I think it become official, you know, that I'm a coach, a bench coach, I think a couple of days ago. And we talk about a little bit about, you know, how he sees everything, how he does his stuff. And I already know how he managed. I really pay attention to the way he was managing and how he liked, what he don't like and stuff like that. So I don't think Tony is a very smart man and he's well prepared. I don't think he will have any problem. I will help him with the, you know, of course, there's a lot of young kids, but I don't think it will not make any difference. I will help him with all that stuff.
Chuck Garfine.
Obviously, you're starting out as a bench coach, but I mean, is it your, you know, hope that one day you become a manager in the major leagues? Is that, you know, a goal of yours?
I'm gonna tell you right now is one step at a time, and you know, I'm gonna really be a bench coach, and I'm gonna learn the most I can with him, and I'm gonna help him the most I can. I know I bring a lot to the table, and I like to have fun. I like to win. I like to, you know, I want to make impact in these young kids, these talented kids, because they're very talented. And the impact that I want to bring is just, I want to make sure they learn how to prepare to win. And that's important. They already know. I know they got that taste, and I saw them in the playing in TV, and I know they like to win. So it's gonna be cool.
James, go ahead.
We were talking to Ethan Katz yesterday. He was talking about how meticulous Tony is about planning out spring training. You've come to a Tony La Russa spring training. Just what is that like, and how much does he really kind of focus on the work and preparing teams for a season?
He's very detail oriented. You know, he want to prepare to, when we leave Glendale to go to Chicago, we in the same page. We prepare to win, and that's something that he's very detail oriented. I love the way I was with him in two spring training, and believe me, we were ready to go to St. Louis when we were there, and you know, we make the playoff twice. So he knows what he's doing.
We have any more questions for Miguel in English? I don't have anything else in the queue right now. And if we don't, if you have a question for Miguel in Spanish, go ahead and raise your hand and we will get to those questions. Daniel Alvarez, go ahead, Daniel.
Thank you. Miguel, saludos y felicitaciones por tu nombramiento como bench coach. Nada, quisiera saber tus impresiones sobre esto ahora y el reto que tienes adelante, que por supuesto es un gran paso y que quizás no todos lo teníamos en el radar y cayó como una sorpresa, pero una sorpresa bien agradable saber que ahora eres bench coach y que vas subiendo progresivamente como técnico.
Mira, va a ser una experiencia increíble. Gracias a Dios, voy a tener la oportunidad de estar al lado de Tony La Russa, que es, mira, el Salón de la Fama, uno de los managers con más preparación para dirigir un equipo. Y, mira, va a ser una experiencia bastante grata. Estoy buscando que empiece entrenamiento ya en Glendale. Este equipo tiene un conjunto de muchachos que tiene un talento increíble. Y mira, este es el primer paso que considero aprender de él. Ahora pasé mucho tiempo con mi familia, quería ver a mis hijos crecer, quería ver a mi hijo jugar pelota. Tengo la oportunidad que estaba viendo a mi hija jugar voleibol, y ahora yo creo que esta es la oportunidad que tengo de volver otra vez a Grandes Ligas, de volver otra vez a estar al lado de buenos coaches, porque todos los coches que tienen el equipo son bastante buenos.
Gracias, Miguel.
Next question, Victor Bocón. Go ahead, Victor.
Saludos, Miguel. Bueno, de antemano, felicitaciones por este nuevo rol, ¿no? Esta nueva experiencia, tal cual como tú lo mencionas. Miguel, a lo largo de tu carrera, tú has tenido diferentes visiones, ¿no? De juego. Estuviste como asistente de manager del gerente general en Cincinnati, luego coach de banca, también como coordinador de fildeo en los Yankees, y ahora este rol de coach de banca y mano derecha de Tony La Russa. ¿Qué ideas nuevas, tomando todo lo que has aprendido a lo largo de tu carrera, vas a llevar al equipo de los Medias Blancas?
Mira, el juego ha cambiado un poco. La pelota nunca ha cambiado. El juego ha cambiado un poco. Ahora hay más información que viene de la oficina. Antes era más que todo la preparación tuya, buscando todos los números y tal. Ahora tienes la oportunidad que tiene mucha información que te traen. El trabajo mío va a ser simplificar toda esa información, tratar de pasársela al manager, a los peloteros. El juego sigue siendo el mismo. Ha cambiado un poco, pero lo importante, a mí me gusta ser agresivo, me gusta ganar, como se lo dije a los otros reporteros. Me gusta mantener el clubhouse bastante luz, tranquilo. La presión te la pones tú mismo. Esa es una cosa que yo aprendí y quiero pasársela a esa a los muchachos. Mira, sinceramente, voy a estar preparado. Lo que aprendí con Tony fue estar preparado antes que las cosas pasen, anticipar todo lo que puede pasar. Y eso creo que cuando las cosas pasen ya tú estás preparado y no te agarran ante de mano.
Next question, Marcus Grunfeld. Go ahead, Marcus. Marcos, I'm sorry.
Hola, Miguel, ¿cómo estás? Buenas tardes. Felicidades por este nombramiento para ti y bueno, mucho éxito en este nuevo proyecto que alcanzas con los Medias Blancas de Chicago. Quería consultarte si en los Yankees, en tu experiencia cuando estuviste con los Yankees, trabajaste con Carlos Mendoza y bueno, ¿qué aprendieron juntos allí? Carlos también junto contigo ahorita se proyectan como los candidatos venezolanos que están más cerca a dirigir en las grandes ligas y bueno, ¿cómo fue, si tuviste la oportunidad de trabajar con él, cómo fue esa experiencia y bueno, ¿qué aprendiste en los Yankees que te puede servir para esta oportunidad que tienes con los Medias Blancas ahora?
Mira, Carlito, mira, intercambiamos mucha información, comunicación, por supuesto la experiencia que tuve en Grandes Ligas, con mucho gusto yo a veces le decía, él me decía porque ya estaba en Grandes Ligas, pero... Por ejemplo, los Yankees es una organización que ahorita está, se lleva mucha de la información, del data, y él, mira, Carlos es tremendo coach, ha aprendido mucho de lo que se está haciendo, está bien avanzado en cómo tratar a la persona como coach, está bien preparado. Siempre cuando tú tienes algo que tú has aprendido por tantos años jugando, Y tú conoces a una persona que yo lo conocía a él también, y estaba tratando de pasar mi experiencia y enseñarle a cosas que yo sabía, y a la misma vez él estaba bien incluido en lo que es ahorita la información con computadoras, con los números, con toda la data que se está viendo. Y mira, lo que aprendí con los Yankees en esa parte es increíble. Tienen demasiada información y, o sea, a veces demasiada y mucho es demasiado. A veces mucho es demasiado. Pero uno tiene que aprender a simplificarla y eso es lo que hace muy bien él.
Gracias, Miguel.
Daniel Alvarez.
Miguel, mencionas algo importante con eso de la data y toda la información que hay y mucho es demasiado. Y es por eso que te quería preguntar, por ese balance, quizás, que es lo que debería ser lo ideal, ¿no? Con lo tradicional, con el instinto y la experiencia que tienes, juntando con ese conocimiento y toda esa información que tienes ahí. ¿Cómo encontrar eso? ¿Y cómo va a ser el reto de trabajarlo ahora con Tony, sabiendo que, bueno, cuando él dirigió por última vez en 2011, de ahí en adelante han cambiado muchas cosas en la pelota, pero como tú dices, sigue siendo el mismo juego?
Sí, Daniel, mira, una cosa que Tony hacía antes de que saliera toda la información, el data que ahorita se da, Tony lo hacía mentalmente. Es lo increíble lo buen preparado que está él en el béisbol, que ahora, más que todo, tú tienes personas que te sacan todo de la computadora, te la dan, tú la ves, tú la acomodas a lo que tú estás viendo con el juego. Y la palabra más importante que tú dijiste fue balance. Mira, todo equipo tiene que tener balance, como un estado de picheo tiene que tener balance, un line-up tiene que tener balance. Y eso es lo que yo he aprendido. Cómo agarrar esa información, simplificarla y pasársela al pelotero. Mira, el juego ya prácticamente es bastante, es duro. O sea, es difícil, el juego es difícil. Ahora, si lo vamos a hacer más difícil para el pelotero, ahí es donde está el error. Lo importante es simplificarlo y darle la información que es correcta y dejar que pase las cosas.
Víctor Bocón. Go ahead, Víctor.
Miguel, una de las cosas que tú mencionaste en la ronda de preguntas en inglés fue tu gran vínculo con Tony La Russa. Acabas de decir algo importante, que después de disfrutar tu familia, tus hijos, regresas propiamente al terreno y estar al lado de un salón de la fama. ¿Qué representa para ti, no, que ese retorno al campo sea al lado de Tony La Russa, que han compartido muchas vivencias, primero siendo tu jugador para él y luego, digamos, en el mismo nivel de técnico?
Mira, Víctor, una de las cosas que, como se lo dije a los muchachos, a los otros reporteros en inglés, hice las cosas porque quería aprender. Siempre en mi carrera yo quería aprender. Tuve la oportunidad de aprender mucho con Ozzie Guillén, que fue manager de Chicago, cuando jugué con él en Tampa. Y mira, cuando jugué con él, yo quería aprender porque tenía pensado qué es lo que iba a hacer después que jugara béisbol. Como tú sabes, ser utility, tú estás pendiente de lo que está pasando, estás viendo el juego, y hay algunos peloteros que no toman esa parte tan importante con mucha importancia. Y con Tony, mira, con Tony está, cuando yo jugué con él, la relación, el respeto que tuvimos como pelotero y como coach fue increíble. Si tú juegas duro para él, te quieren más increíblemente. Tú sabes, pelotero que no juega duro, ¿cómo va a jugar? Pero una cosa que yo hice fue estar preparado. Cuando salí a jugar, estaba preparado para jugar, me gustaba ganar, y una de las cosas que me imagino que él le gustó de mí fue que yo siempre estaba preparado para lo que sea, preparado para salir a hacer mi trabajo. Y este otro nuevo reto con él, tengo que estar preparado, tengo que estar ayudarlo en todas las cosas. Mantener, me imagino, tengo que mantener el dogado contento, que esté encima a trabajar duro, y la meta final, que es ganar y el playoff y ganar la Serie Mundial.
Gracias, Miguel.
A su orden.
Marcos, go ahead.
Miguel, quería preguntarte qué tanto te entusiasma trabajar, porque yo sé que vienes de una organización que tenía muchísimo talento, pero los Medias Blancas de Chicago ahorita tienen a Luis Robert, Giolito, a Lucas Giolito, tienen a José Abreu, que acaba de ganar el MVP, tienen una serie de jugadores muy talentosos, Joan Moncada, etc. Realmente tienen un equipo bastante completo. Bueno, esperando obviamente que el año que viene sí pueda encontrar con Kopech. ¿Qué tanto te entusiasma trabajar con ellos? Y la segunda pregunta que te haría es, ¿has soñado con tener la posibilidad de dirigir en Venezuela?
La primera pregunta, mira, yo tengo pasión para lo que hago. La pasión que tengo, el entusiasmo que tengo es cuando me decido hacer algo, doy el 100%. No me gusta hacer las cosas a mitad. Si esto es una meta que me he preparado, que quiero hacer, y es, ser coach en Grandes Ligas, impactar a los peloteros de la manera correcta, para ellos que enseñen, que aprendan a ganar. Y mira, para mí es un reto y los retos los tomo bastante en serio. Me gusta, yo sé el talento que hay en el equipo y ser parte de la organización de Chicago White Sox, que mira, por muchos años ha sido una de las mejores organizaciones de béisbol, es increíble. Y la segunda pregunta, por supuesto, ¿sabes por qué no? Por supuesto me gustaría manejar en Venezuela, en cualquier lado.
Okay, we don't have any more questions in the queue. Miguel, thank you very much for your time and your answers today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much, man.
Thank you, Miguel. And we'll talk to you soon. Thank you, everybody, for jumping on with us. We'll have our links posted shortly. Thanks, everyone.